This is a story about an Australian schoolboy who disappeared into the Syrian prison system after the fall of IS.
Yusuf?
Last week on Dateline, we found Yusuf Zahab.
Australian? You're Australian?
And heard his story.
I want to see my mother. I just want to go back to Australia.
Yusuf was sent to a men's prison at age 15.
Got beaten up so much. I'm scared I'm going to die here. So many people died in prison.
For the past 5 years, family back in Australia have been desperately searching for news.
Why were we the first Australians that Yusuf has spoken to in 5 years?
There's a lot of questions, but that's the very obvious one.
He's being held without charge or trial, just like most of the Australians who lived under IS, including children.
Where are you from?
Australia.
Who could end up in prison just like Yusuf.
If they take them away from me, I might never see them again. I don't know what they'll do to them.
Will Australia bring them home?
This is not a question of compassion. It's a question of keeping Australians safe.
The basic rule of international law is each country is responsible for its own. You don't shed your nationals like debris and have other countries be responsible for them.
I'm en route to Al Roj, one of the detention centres in northeastern Syria. The camp holds thousands of women and children who once lived under the Islamic State group's caliphate. The region is currently run by the US-backed Syrian Democratic Forces, or SDF. They're the Kurdish-led militia that defeated IS. But this morning, their enemies have struck.
Well, there was a Turkish drone target like one of the cars in the town. I mean, they hit this car, and as far as I knew, the three cars have been targeted this morning.
Recently, there have been hundreds of drone strikes in the region. Turkey says it's targeting militants associated with the Kurdistan Workers' Party, or PKK. The SDF says they are not associated with the PKK, and that the airstrikes are targeting infrastructure, their officials, and destabilizing the region. As crowds gather, somebody notices the drone is back.
Yeah, drone.
Is that Jimmy? There is a drone above us.
Let's get out from the car.
Without camera.
Let's get out, guys.
So why without the camera?
Yeah, because if they see the camera, I mean, they might target that. They might target the car.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right, we're getting out.
Yeah. We've just had to get out of our vehicle, and our vehicle's actually just left because our driver was very worried. He said that a local journalist who had filmed a drone strike recently was then killed in a drone strike on his vehicle, so he understandably wants us to get out of here because I had my camera.
Yeah, I think that's cool.
We're good. Let's go. Yeah. Back in the car.
Yeah.
Different car, yeah?
Yeah.
When I arrive at Al Roj camp, everyone is anxious about the strikes. For the 34 Australians here in the camp, it's a reminder that they're stuck in a hostile environment.
We're a bit worried. We heard a bomb about 10 minutes ago, so we were freaking out. We're like, are they still coming in? Are they going to come in? So we're glad that you guys came through.
What happened? What did you hear?
Just a really loud explosion. The situation's only getting worse. You know, we're in such a difficult regionally, everything, you know, it's such a difficult area to be in, and the situation's only deteriorating.
In late 2022, the Albanese government repatriated 17 women and children. But over a year later, the remaining Australian women are confused and scared as to why they're still here. Zara Ahmed is a mum of three boys.
Okay, I went, look. You do me a nice big love heart. Oh, you're drawing mummy, okay. And a yo-yo. Well done. What about my love heart?
Zara's family makes up the largest group in Al Roj. Her mother is here, and so are her three sisters. For Zara, the longer she waits for news of repatriation, the more dangerous it is for her family.
Children here, the big boys, are potentially at risk of being taken away from mum. It has happened. and it's very, very, very scary. I can't explain to you the amount of fear that we feel, the amount of anxiety that we feel constantly.
UN experts say that adolescent boys are separated from their mothers on the Kurdish authorities' belief that they pose a security risk.
Do they know the story of Yusuf?
Yes, they're aware of Yusuf's story. They're very scared. They're very scared that that might happen to them, especially since Yusuf was 15 when he was taken away from mum. And Mohammed is 12 now.
Mummy.
Okay, now, how many threes go into 16?
Two, remainder one. No, five, remainder one.
Well done. Very good.
Do you remember school?
He's never been to school.
How come he's never been to school?
Because he was only two when he left Australia. All I want to do is save them from the trauma and save them. So I will just kind of make it like everything's fine. You know, Mum, no worries, everything's good. Even if it's not good, for me, put on a brave face, it's okay. You know, because I remember even me growing up. If Mum and Dad are good, I'm good.
What's happening to you inside?
Oh, inside's...
Can't be easy here.
If they take them away from me, I might never see them again. I don't know what they'll do to them. I can't have that happen to my kids. They're innocent. They haven't done anything wrong. I don't believe they should be punished for something that they don't even have anything to do with.
Zara says Australian authorities came to the camp in 2022 to process travel documentation for the women and children. They thought they'd all be leaving.
You know, it gave us a bit of light. Then they took the first group, and then we were still holding on to, you know, maybe, you know, every car we would hear would say, oh, maybe they're here to come take us. You know, it's our turn. And the kids every day had their shoes ready on the door, had their clothes ready to get dressed to go, had their bags ready.
I have to ask, are you a security concern if you go back to Australia?
You can ask anybody about the Australians in the camp, from the military intelligence to the soldiers, to the shopkeepers, to the organisations. They always say the Australians are the one group that are just, you know, outstanding.
The Australian public won't really get the chance to ask the Kurds here, but they will think that you've been locked up here alongside ISIS supporters.
Of course, and I understand that. And I think I would have the same concern if I was back home. But what I would like to say is don't be so quick to judge. Try and look at it from our perspective. We are also mothers, you know, we're human beings at the end of the day. The fact that we're saying that we're willing to comply to whatever the government wants, you know, we're not hiding.
You'll often hear in Australia, you made this bed, you can sleep in it. What do you say to that comment?
I didn't make this bed, so that I'm not gonna answer that, you know, because it's for me that doesn't apply. Yeah, like most of the women in the camp doesn't apply.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that we're now forced to suffer for the decisions that other people, other, you know, male influencers have made on our behalf. And now they're all gone and we're left to suffer with our kids.
It's estimated about 200 Australians travelled to Syria and Iraq to join IS or to live in territory under its control. Yusuf's mother, Amina, blames her two older sons for coercing the family to Syria.
So it was the boys. Just as hard as...
Your sons, yes. Mohammed and Khalid?
Yes, Mohammed and Khalid, it was the boys. We were trafficked. We were tricked into coming here. We didn't come here because on our own two feet, because we wanted to. I've come to the conclusion I really, really feel that they were brainwashed somehow. And Yusuf is his own story. He is not his brother's. He's someone completely different.
Welcome, that's very nice.
And while many men died during the war, including Yusuf's older brothers, by our count, only around 13 Australian men are here in prison. The head of Yusuf's house was his father, Hisham. He was reported to have died from tuberculosis in prison. Hi, Hisham. This is the first time Hisham Zahab has been publicly seen in 4.5 years. I'm Colin Cozier from Australia. I'm Australian. I'm from the program Dateline on SBS television. Tell me who you are.
My name is Hisham Zahab. I'm from Australia, Sydney.
Are you okay to do this interview?
Yeah, I'll try.
When was the last time you saw your family?
5 years ago, they left, and I give up myself. And I have a son. He was 14 years old. He's in the jail in somewhere, I don't know. I asked to meet him. They never let me. So we separated 5 years. I don't know if he's still alive or he's dead.
We have met Yusuf on this trip.
You met him?
We met Yusuf. We spoke to him like we're speaking to you now.
How is he?
He seems okay. He seems okay considering. Yeah. He said that he misses his family and he misses Australia.
I miss him too. And I miss Stanet.
Are you okay today? You look cold, like you're shaking.
Because when I come here, my heart beating a lot, so I have pressure in my chest. That's all.
Are you okay? Do you want a drink?
I'm fine. They give me some water outside.
What did you think was happening when you came here today?
I don't know. I've been through a lot. I'm scared maybe they're gonna beat me.
Have you been charged with anything?
No, they not charge me or anything.
What do you understand about why you're here?
I understand, because I come to Syria. The reason I come to Syria to take my sons back to Australia, and I couldn't make it, so I stuck in this quicksand.
Hisham and Amina had two older sons, a daughter and Yusuf. Mohammed was a senior IS member and already in Syria. Sumaya had been there since 2014. It's alleged that in 2015, the rest of the family went to the border to try to rescue Sumaya. But Amina says Khaled tricked the family and trafficked them across the border. Yusuf backs this up, saying Khaled was responsible. But Hisham's story doesn't quite match up.
You went from Lebanon to Turkey with Khaled, yes?
Yes. So?
Did he trick you into crossing the border, or why did you cross the border?
He wanted to meet his brother too. He wanted to convince him to come back to Australia too.
Was Khaled at that point a member of the Islamic State?
No.
I understand why you would want to get your son and your daughter back. It doesn't make sense though why you would take your wife and young child into Syria to try and convince them. It wouldn't be safe.
When we call them, they say safe. You can go inside and go out. It's easy. They lost.
And you believed them?
I believe.
How do you feel towards your sons now, Mohammed and Khaled?
May Allah forgive them. That's what I say.
Were you or are you a member of the Islamic State?
No.
Was Yusuf a member of the Islamic State?
because he's so young, he never knew.
Did his brothers radicalize him? Did they brainwash him to become part of Islamic State?
They tried. But he always was with me.
Who do you think is responsible for you and your family being in this position?
Me. I put it in my... I'm responsible. Because I'm the oldest and I'm the man of the family.
If you can see Yusuf, what would you say to him?
I'm sorry. I want to say sorry to him. Because he's been so not. And he was so young to be in a jail. Maybe I'm going to lose my mind if something happened to him.
He's okay. We spoke to him. He's 20 now.
He's 20 now. He's a man.
Do you still have hope?
Yeah. I hope. Government is starting to take us back. That's what I hope.
I come away from meeting Hisham with more questions than I went in with. Was the family coerced by the sons into entering Syria? Or was Hisham in on the plan all along? I don't think I'll find out here. In 2015, the Australian Federal Police used proceeds of crime legislation to freeze Zahab family assets in Australia, claiming some of the funds from the sale of their Western Sydney home were destined for IS. Court documents named Hisham, Amina, and their son Mohammed. In early 2017, it was reported that Kuwaiti authorities charged Hisham with financing terrorism, money laundering, and joining a terrorist organisation. But Yusuf doesn't think his parents are to blame.
I always say my mind is because of my brothers, not because of my mother and father. Because what I saw in my mother and father, before in Australia, they just wanted to sell the house and buy a new house and live life again, but just a smaller house.
Why do you think you've been left here?
I don't know why. That's the question I wish to ask you. I don't know why. I actually don't know why I'm here. I'm 5 years now. I don't know why. I don't know because they claim that I'm dead outside. I don't know even why.
I wasn't able to see the conditions that Yusuf and Hisham are held in. But in July last year, the UN Special Rapporteur for Human Rights and Counter-Terrorism visited several prisons and camps. She wrote a report on what she found.
I think the report is damning. If you're going to hold somebody, if you're going to deprive them of their liberty, if you're not going to allow someone to leave a place of detention like a prison or a camp, you have to have a legal basis to do it. Not a single Australian who's being held in northeast Syria has had access to any legal process, zero legal process. And so we use that term mass arbitrary detention to describe this kind of gross human rights violation.
What sort of violations are you talking about?
Australian women and men are subject to the most egregious harms under international law, which includes torture, inhuman and degrading treatment, which has included sexualized violence, and which has included the potential of war crimes being committed.
They're Australian citizens, but they're being held by Kurdish authorities in Syria. Who's responsible in this situation?
The basic rule of international law is each country is responsible for its own. You don't shed your nationals like debris and have other countries be responsible for them. And what that means is you bring them back, apply the full force of the law to them. And to be clear, for Australian men or women who have committed crimes in northeast Syria, they should be prosecuted because the victims of terrorism have a right to those prosecutions, but they're never going to be prosecuted in northeast Syria.
Why do you think countries are leaving their citizens here?
Well, I would start by saying there's a whole bunch of foreign nations who haven't and who are working really hard to bring them back. And it's deeply regretful that Australia has not found the political and social capacity to make the hard decisions. And so I think it boils down to political will. The report is really clear that states who refuse to bring their nationals home, given all of the evidence of this kind of the scale and systematization of this abhorrent treatment, are in breach of their international human rights obligations, including the government of Australia.
Fionnuala commends the Kurdish authorities for giving her access to the prisons and camps, knowing full well her report would be damning. The local autonomous administration admits there are problems.
Do you feel abandoned by the international community and being burdened with the responsibility of looking after so many foreigners? The Autonomous Administration of North and East Syria wants to focus on fighting the remnants of IS and dealing with Turkish drone strikes, not looking after foreigners. So, the message to the international community is... After travelling to Syria and meeting Yusuf and his family, I'm still left with many questions about why 55 Australian citizens have been left behind. In late 2022, the government repatriated four women and 13 children from Syria. Kamal Debussy's daughter and grandchildren were among those brought back.
Look, they're doing well. Kids are at school. Mariam cooperated with authorities on return. She's free to get on with life. There is check-ins and discussions that happen. But it's not, there's been nothing, no legal impediment, no charges, nothing's been put to her at all.
Of the four women that were repatriated, only one has been charged with willingly entering Syria. And while his own daughter is now back, Kamal remains as the spokesperson for the families who are still waiting in Syria.
So I think Australia and the UK are the two holdouts as far as repatriation goes. America took their citizens out some time ago. It has stalled, I think, basically for the optics of it, for the politics of it. They are afraid of the political point scoring that might come by the opposition, by them doing this.
When in opposition, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese signals that repatriation was the right thing to do.
Children who are Australian citizens, who've made no choices about where they are, and the circumstances in which they find themselves are deserving of Australia's protection.
3 years later, his government acted. But the news was met with angry reactions from some in Sydney's Assyrian community who'd fled from IS.
We ran away from them because they hurt and they demolished our country.
Some news outlets labelled the returning women as ISIS brides.
That is the ISIS brides from Syria and the 42 children.
The ISIS brides are in our community, in our parks, and they're in our McDonald's.
While the government and the opposition exchanged public blows.
It's not a question of compassion. It's a question of keeping Australians safe.
One of the things that needs to be understood here is that these are Australian citizens.
If we think that threat has gone away, that people wouldn't act out, that there couldn't be an explosion in our country, then I think that's an incredibly naive.
There's been no suggestion that anyone who's come back here is causing any
actual threat to safety.
The political point scoring, I think, became very loud, and it's what spooked the government, I think, in effect.
So when your daughter and the others were brought back, was the expectation at the time that, like, everybody would be out, that more would follow?
Yes. That was very clearly the expectation at that point in time. They were planning on the others almost immediately, or within a matter of weeks, and it stopped.
Last year, Save the Children Australia brought a case to the federal court to compel the government to repatriate the remaining Australian women and children. The case failed, but an appeal is expected to be heard in May. So far, there is no case made for the men or for Yusuf to be brought back.
I wanted to tell you in person that when we spoke to Yusuf, he told me that he had been tortured, beaten up. He talked about being scared he'll die over there, and he said he's seen a lot of people die.
I'm quite shocked to hear and sad to hear that he's been tortured. You know, he's not been protected, and as a child he's been left in this abhorrent situation where he's been exposed to a whole series of things that no child should have to go through.
Now that you know that Yusuf is alive, what next?
We need to go down and kick down the doors of Parliament. You know, we need to get their attention. We need to get them to act to take Yusuf, get him out of harm's way, make him safe. And they're the only ones that can do this. We can't do this. The only people that can act to make him safe is the Australian government.
We sent a list of questions to the Minister's offices at Home Affairs, Foreign Affairs, and the Prime Minister and Cabinet, asking about further plans for repatriation and about Australia's role in the mass indefinite detention of Australian citizens in northeastern Syria. They did not respond to the questions. Home Affairs Minister Claire O'Neill declined an interview request and didn't comment when approached by SBS News.
Minister, on Yusuf Zahab, the Australian detained by Kurdish authorities in northeast Syria, what responsibility does the Australian government have to advocate on his behalf? His family are desperate. What are your response to concerns about his welfare and treatment?
If you won't comment on an individual case, what humanitarian obligation does the government have to children and women stuck in camps in Syria?
But in a recent interview with SBS, the head of ASIO gave a frank assessment of the remaining Australians, including the men.
Obviously, not everyone stuck in Syria is a threat to security. It's an unfortunate situation. Some are, though, and we have to be vigilant about that. We would give advice on whether they're a security threat or not. Bringing them home is other people's responsibilities. But if they're an Australian citizen, they have a right to come home.
My name is Yusuf Hisham Dahab. I'm 2003, I'm 17 years old.
Dateline also asked the SDF in Syria to comment on Yusuf's allegations that he was tortured and beaten. Officials deny his allegations. They say they're doing their best to provide medical help to prisoners, including dangerous IS suspects.
Yusuf and his family have suffered so much. Yusuf is emblematic of everything that's wrong for children in northeast Syria.
He shouldn't have been in a prison. He should have been taken out of there from the beginning. From the beginning. That was the responsibility of our government. Yes, I know my sons made a mistake. I know they did, and it was a big, huge mistake. But he had nothing to do with it. It wasn't him.
What's the news outside? Is Australia going to take me back, or am I going to be able to see my mother at least, or my family, because I've missed them so much? Are they going to take me back to Australia, or when, or what's going to happen to me?